Well, hello there. We are going to be looking at orchestration again today, aspects of Star Wars Episode 4 A New Hope, 8M2 More Rescue, this is. So, obviously, I've already done the complete breakdown of this, which is here, basically. And as you can see, it's complicated. There's all sorts of things going on, basically, sort of lots of octatonic stuff, lots of imperials, lots of scampering tuplets, which is like the main sort of motivic material for the whole thing. Lots of modulations, altered scales. We've got major chords above a Locrian sharp 2 scale, a sort of half dim scale, 734. All sorts of different things. So if you're interested in the actual notes and the pitches and the composition, then I would refer you to that. But we're going to be really focusing on the orchestration pretty much as a sort of standalone thing. I'm just sort of scanning through a few things here for you, just so that you can have a look at it and see how it works, basically. There are all sorts of amazing, you know, big crescendos, textural crescendos with notes going down, notes going up, a typical sort of divergent progression or diverging progression, which he uses a lot in A New Hope, basically when melody sort of goes up and everything out of the bass line goes down, that sort of thing. Yeah, lots of sort of minor chords with sharp fours, that sort of stuff. The usual sort of 3-3 type material. That sort of thing. And then one of the best chords in the whole thing, which is a whole tone scale, would you believe? Which is amazing. But it doesn't sound like it. It sounds like a sort of dominant chord. Like that. And it's used as a sort of almost as a sort of tritone sub for a dominant chord, basically. Those sorts of things, little tricks, are in a very good book, actually, called Contemporary Harmony, Romanticism Through the 12-Tone Row. And I'll put a link to that book. But basically, it sort of goes beyond the normal sort of regular and irregular resolutions of things and kind of talks about modality and scale forms and adding, you know, ninths, elevenths and thirteenths to things, and how they're kind of used to stand alone or how they might resolve or what their purpose is, that sort of thing, without getting massively too technical, which I think is always good, because sometimes that can be really overwhelming, and also quite a lot of the time it's completely unnecessary. But there we go. So we won't be dealing with that, because we're going to be dealing with the orchestration. So as I usually do, I do a little sheet of just things which I think are really interesting. I mean, everything's interesting, but just to highlight a few things. And most of the time, my focus is on things like woodwind, brass, because I'm always fascinated to see how they are done. And invariably, not invariably, but, you know, occasionally we have oboes, clarinets on the top, then oboes on the second voice, then the third voice, and then clarinet on the lowest note. That's not always the case, but it does come up quite frequently. And then we've got sort of blended stacking, oboe 1, oboe 2, and then clarinet 1 beneath. What else have we got? We've got things here where you have a preponderance of notes on the top voice, but then only oboe 2 and blaze clarinet on the... Did I just say blaze clarinet? I think I did. Bass clarinet on the lower octave. And then we've got sort of completely sort of stacked stuff where you just have flutes, then oboes, and then clarinets. That's sort of standard as well. But then we have sort of interesting things where you might have flute 1 and 2 on the top, but then flute 3 in the clarinet, then oboe 2 in the clarinet 2, then oboe 1. Huh? And then oboe 1 and oboe 2 swap. This sort of weird sort of cross-voicing, which is a sort of Stravinsky technique, really. Flute 1 and 2 on the top here. Flute 3, oboe and clarinet on the middle note. Of playing the third. And then oboe 2 and clarinet 2 on the root note. So that's really interesting. It's sort of slightly odd voices here, and then we've got oboe 1 on its own, then oboe 2, clarinet 1, clarinet 2. There's a sort of Beethoven type thing going on. A lot of the time, oboe 2 and clarinet 1 in lots of Beethoven symphonies tend to play the same note as well. Yes, and it could be that this particular one in bar 62, we've got the oboe clarinet playing that note. Obviously, the trumpets are giving, you know, the main thing, so it's just colouring, really, the trumpets. But I just wonder whether that colour is more of a concord, really, because it's a bit like a sort of a minor sixth, although it's not. It could be that, whereas the A is actually really discordant with the minor ninth. So it could be for that reason, I'm not sure. But I reckon it probably is. Let's try and just rectify that a little bit. So I will go through all of this just sort of, build up to it. So the first one is going to be bar 6. But let's just have a look at the whole thing to begin with. And I'm going to just try and make it a little bit bigger. So the very, very first bit of this is all sort of bass heavy. Let's have a quick listen. Has one note which is missing from the fill. Okay, I can't play all of it because I just can't fit everything on the stave, basically. It's too big. And also, if I make it really small, then you can't see anything at all. So, that's why I sort of put reductions on these things, because otherwise it's just impossible to see anything. First thing to point out, the bass. So it's a reinforced bass. We've got the double bass and the cellos and octaves. That's absolutely standard. This time we've actually got piano with it as well. We've got a big cymbal crash. We've got a timpani, which is playing the octave above. We've got the two tubas, but of course, normally that would be bass trombone on that note and a big tuba on that note, and then reinforced with another sort of third trombone there. And then we've also got contrabassoon playing very low D, as well as both bassoons a two. So we get a really big sound. So on Spalius note, like that. So it very much is a big reinforced bass line. Then we've got a little technique which you see a lot of the time. So when horns come in with forte, sometimes it's reinforced with a harp or string pits. In this case, the string pits are actually coming in a bit later because of the piano and also the wind. So those are already assigned to that. But I suppose there's nothing to stop you putting the string pits here and then a harp thing there. It's just sort of personal choice, really. And obviously there's more of them as well, so it's going to be louder. But it just reinforces the attack of the notes. So the other thing to point in, to bear in mind is that there are three sort of two cascades of things, basically, in terms of harmony. We've got B flat minor chord here, which is just in the horns and nothing else. We've got A minor, which is mixed with the wind. And then we've got the bass D. So there are three levels, if you see what I mean, and they're all sort of separated out quite nicely in terms of instrumentation and space as well. So they're all in sort of close position. These are also in close position, if you think about it, because it's the closest they can get to, and they're all stacked. So you get oboe 1, oboe 2, then clarinet 1. So that's the first sort of bit at that point, which is kind of what I've done here. That is that. Anything else doubling those strings? Well, kind of. Anything else doubling those trumpets? Well, at the same register, only the piano octave in this bit is, and then the other octave is kind of covering the other bit of the wind. But we also have a mixed mode here, so you have oboes and clarinets doubling that, so we can just listen to that on its own. There we go. And you get that sort of little buzzing sound. And then we've also got that going. And then with the pits, which just reinforces that piano a little bit. There we go. It's quite difficult to sort of hear. Let's see whether we can pick it out of this. Get that little sort of percussive sound effect, basically, without having to use any percussion at all. There is a cymbal roll which will sort of come into this sort of triplet thing. So that's the first bit. The second bit is introducing this material, which is sort of octatonic. So this rising horn idea also appears in bar 35, and it's sort of repeated alongside imperials, which is this thing. Whoops. Like that. I can't trill everybody, but there we go. Alongside some interesting sort of contrapuntal idea, which is just in unison with viola and cello. And it seems piano as well. So let's just listen to, let's have a look at that bit. So this section here doesn't appear to have anything else with it. And this is just the horns. I think that should be all of the horns because I continue them. I always keep finding little errors. It's really annoying. But they're always there, which is a bit frustrating. So yes, nothing else plays this line. There we go. And notice it just jumps up a little bit as well. It's not quite a whole sort of sequence as one might expect. And also there's nothing else going along, actually. So it's complete separation of sound. And then we have a slightly reinforced E flat with a just trombone hit. Secco just means dry or basically just very short. Then we've got trumpets, again, a complete separation of function. So a sort of quasi-melod, well, it's basically a melody, but harmonized melody in block chordal. Don't think there's anything else playing that. We get a little bit of reinforcement from arco right at the beginning of the note, but I don't think anything else is really playing this at all. And notice that there's no doubling at the octave, there's no wind doubling at an octave higher, nothing else. The other bit which we've got is this sort of counterpoint, which effectively becomes the bass, essentially. And that is just going through bass clarinet, bassoons, and contra. And it's just going through the basic thing. Let me just put a bass clef in the bass clarinet because we're in concert pitch here. Just going through the orchestra in terms of register. So once it gets to there, there's nothing else there. In fact, there's nothing else there. You'll see that the cello stops on the lowest note, C. Of course it does, because it can't play any lower without using a peg. I think there's a Schubert piece that does that, where there's a very low B right at the end of the whole thing with a few bars rest to sort of tune it. Can't remember what that piece is. Maybe it's Schumann, but I'm pretty sure it is. Could be the cello quintet or something like that. I can't remember now. Somebody will be able to tell me. But yeah, and of course it just goes through the motions, very sort of Tchaikovsky-esque, basically. So that bit is a little bit more blended, isn't it? Because we've got some wind, low wind, with piano and violas, cellos, contrabassoon. I'm going to ignore that, really, because it's irrelevant for the sake of this. And then reinforced again with a second piano at that point, which is also got some timps going on. Notice that they're playing different notes, by the way. There's not sort of going to be that run of things. Again, a sort of complete separation of function. Very French, very Russian in its orchestration method. So then the triplet is taken up by unison strings, which is again a very common thing that he does with a little bit of pizzicato on here. Notice there's no double bass at that point, so there's no need to reinforce it with anything, hence why there's no bassoons or contrabassoon, because that's it. Generally speaking, and it's sometimes advisable, if you have double basses on their own, they can get a bit lost. Unless they've got some doubling, depending on the dynamic register that you're working in. So you just need to, it just needs care. I'm not saying that there's a default to it, but it just needs care and attention. When I say doubling, that could be unison doubling or an octave higher. So this little passage, is that repeated anywhere else? The answer is no. So actually, it's not quite unison at that point. But it's all octatonic, and you can see all of those sort of changes again as well. We get a little bit of filigree at the top, which is just sort of unison stuff. Piccolo, of course, just actually does play an octave higher. So it just is this. Usually a sort of harmonic minor, melodic minor, that sort of thing. He often has a... make sure there's a leading note to get to the target note. This is just a sort of eight note one. That's quasi... actually, it's quasi octatonic. Otherwise, it would be that. So he just changes it around because he probably thinks it's awkward to do. Like that. So it's sort of a quasi sort of scale at that point. Just changes it really for the ease of the players more than anything else. I'm at bar 12 here, which was, I think, where are we? Yeah, we haven't quite got to that bit yet. So I sort of said oboes and clarinets, but how are they actually mixed? Well, we've got oboe and clarinet one on the top note. So oboe and clarinet sharing the top voice as they do so often, then oboe the two beneath, and then clarinet two takes the lowest note at this point. So when you've got four instruments but only a triad, oboe and clarinet basically share the top note. I think the clarinet is there to stop the oboe being too penetrating, essentially. It just dulls it slightly, which is actually a good thing at that point. And that became more and more common as the sort of the years go on. In orchestration, particularly modern orchestration. So we've got oboe and clarinet one on the top note there. We've got oboe two, clarinet two at that point. Double check that I have got that absolutely correct. Sorry. oboe two and clarinet two on the third and the root at that point. So then we've got the trumpets actually playing an octave higher. So there is a slight mixed colour at that point, but nothing else. Then we've got a little bit of melody, which is continuing the triplet idea, but it's not quite the same thing. Notice how the emphasis on the strings is coming a beat early, which is interesting. It's sort of like hitting the climax before the next phrase, which is quite interesting. Yeah, it's this bit here. Very sort of Holstian. Yeah. So very high trumpets at that point. Well, not very high, but sort of quite high. And the strings sort of reinforce that. Yeah, notice how the strings sort of catch up with themselves. So it's just that they've already reached the climactic point there, but actually the bass line is going there and everything else is also going there as well. Not quite sure why I wrote query there. Yeah, it's interesting. There's a little cascade of sort of colours and accents. As we arrive, there's one there, there's one in the bass line, and then of course there's one in the horns which take over, which is the same sort of material, but it's all sort of passed around the orchestra. So it's again really, really interesting. So the wind reinforced this bit. The trombones probably don't need any reinforcement at all. Really, they are transforming the horn line and just adding weight to that. And we've also got this over the top as well. Like that. And we can see how the roll just changes very, very slightly in the strings as this sort of continues. So let's just listen to that again. Yeah. Notice that there's no repeated notes here. I think, again, to add weight to the power beneath it. We've then got another trumpet line, which is sort of, again, just imitating this, but in augmentation. So it's very sort of Brahmsian in its sort of melodic treatment in that regard. Yeah. Interesting that there's no reiterated anticipation chord or anticipation note here in the trumpets. It just goes straight through, but it kind of then follows the roll, you know, so that the rolls are now all the same once we get to that bit, like that. And then we got a little bit of filigree to just help with the attack of those notes in the wind, like that. We've also got some sort of, glock, twinkle, jingle, whatever, tinkle. And then bass line, we've got bass clarinets, bassoons, contrabassoon, all doing what the strings are doing. So a reinforced string with piano. But you'll see how clear it is in terms of the orchestration. Yeah. There's the bass line. There's this line, which is sort of combining with those two. So that's the second thing. The third thing, which is kind of related to the second thing, is there. And then we've got a fourth thing, which is the filigree. So really three main ideas, but they're slightly different in the brass because of this sort of fanfare-like thing. Let's just listen to it once more, but with everything. Very, very clear and concise, because there's so much going on. You don't need as much octave doubling. So notice that the doubling tends to be unison. Of course, we've got piccolo, so there is one octave there. But that is all the same thing, but there's one octave there. So there are two octave levels, I suppose, you know, in the sense that that is that and that's an octave below. But then they're not sort of doing all of this sort of stuff with loads and loads of doubling. And the reason for that is, again, clarity. If you start sort of mucking around with this sort of thing and doing an octave lower, an octave higher and everything, it will disturb the clarity of whatever's going on. So in this bit here, again, that's just sort of reinforcing those trumpets with just a couple of notes of the triad a bit higher. There we go. And notice that there's no need to play that final note here, because otherwise it wouldn't be able to get down from the shift to then do this sort of next bit of octatonic work. So string bubbling as well, 15, 16 at that point. Not quite a bubble. A bubble is a bit more tremolando, that sort of thing. So let's move on to 28, which is a little bit... Yeah, a little bit more over here. Maybe just a little bit here. What happens when we got four note chords? So here we just got this line like that. What are the wind doing at that point? So we know that we got the trumpets though. So this is 25. So I don't think I included this particularly, but let's have a look at it anyway. And I think I probably did this because it's slightly different. So actually, this particular bit is a bit different. So we have flutes in normal triadic form, just in standard close position. But then we've got clarinet above oboe, then oboe 2, and then clarinet 2. So clarinets enclosing the oboes. Very, very common. Let's have a listen to it. Yeah. And notice that the lowest note is G sharp. If that was oboe 2, it would sound a bit sort of a bit duck-like, I'm pretty sure. I suppose it's covered a little bit by the fact that there's horn already doing that note. So that's it's a mixed colour by the end of the time where they start doing that. So we'll see that if we put that in. And of course, we've got trumpets there as well. Like that. And yeah, nothing else doing that. But it, I think, you know, let's just take note. Flute 1, flute 2, flute 3, yes. Clarinet 1, oboe 1, oboe 2, clarinet 2. Yeah, just to reiterate, clarinet above oboe, and then clarinet 2. And slight mixed colour at that point as well. Next bit. So let's go on to bar 28. So it's this bit here. Yeah, so this whole sort of section. Yeah. So really the orchestration is very, very clear. We've got bass line, which is in here. Pianos, harps. Don't think anything else plays that at all. Notice there are no bassoons at that point. The reinforcement for the double basses comes from the cellos and a little bit of harp as well. And of course, this second piano. This is just the bass line. Like that. Notice that there's no tuba, absolutely no need for that at all. Doesn't need that reinforcement. And so we would then call it a sort of quite a clear bass. We've then got this material in just the horns, and I don't think it's repeated anywhere else. Nope. So this material just in the horns. And it's all atu, 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 by the way. Yeah. So a complete separation of chordal function. What's then happening with the wind? So just stacked, but this time, instead of clarinet and then oboe and stuff, we've got oboe 1, oboe 2, clarinet 1. So it's a little bit different from what we had before in the bars before. Notice how high the oboe goes. And there's a little bit of piano colour that's just colourising that a little bit, because that will get a little bit lost, that oboe one. Let's just see what the orchestra is doing with it. Let's see if I can actually find it. Yeah, so we're coming up to it. Yeah, it's quite pokey, that oboe, isn't it? Interesting. Yeah, so for me, that was the note that really poked out at that point. But then it gets subsumed this time with the flute sound by that note as well. Let me just see whether I can just take it back a little bit quicker. Yeah, it's just a little bit loud on the B, but that just could be the way it's played. That's all. But I think the orchestration is sound, obviously. So we then get on to the next little bit. So that was all of that. So blended stacking with oboes above clarinet, note separation and chordal function. So that was that whole sort of bit there. And then the next bit I go on to bar 37. So what's happening before bar 37? Is there anything that I can talk about with interest? Oh, hate it when it does that. It's annoying. Not hugely. particularly, again, just the usual trumpets in octaves with trombones. Like that. Where the trombones actually then take over another sort of harmonic role with the melody actually in a little bit of flute, bass clarinet, but again mostly strings and a little bit of harp as well, which just gives it a nice little bit of added colour at that point. So yeah, one of the interesting things about this is look at how low that flute is to start off with, but then how high it gets, and then how low the bass clarinet is, and then how high it gets. Like that, sort of quite an interesting sort of colour aspect here. Notice there are no violas. Cellos, the violins, all on the same thing. We've got the harps. And we've got this. So another mixed colour sound. Yeah, and then it sort of jumps back almost as well at that point. So it is going into our sort of melodic bit. Which is slightly unfair just to talk about that. And we will talk about it. So here, let's see what we've got. We've got flute 1 and flute 2 and flute 3 on the same note, and oboe 1 on the same note, and both clarinets on the same note, and then only oboe 2 and only bass clarinet on the lower octave. And viola. So we've got the viola joining that, which is really interesting. Good use of violas. Very consistent. Exactly the same orchestration. Yeah, exactly the same orchestration all the way through. Not sure why it's doing that. That's just really annoying. I think it's because I've got some sort of setting on it, which is, yeah, auto. Yeah, there we go. Hopefully it shouldn't keep doing that all the time. What else is happening in the bass? So you'll notice that because the contrabassoon won't speak very clearly at that speed, but it's just doing the important notes at that point. However, the trombones, the tuba, and the timpani give weight to that. So it's a bass line, but with added chords. So block chordal homophony with a bass. Same orchestration. Like that, with trumpets coming in right at the very, very end as well. So again, amazing consistency with all of that. And then we've got the third idea, which is this scampering stuff. So we've got three things going on. We've got the main tune. We've got the bass line with added harmony, which is mostly an open position at this point. Notice how the formation of those bass notes are interesting. So dyadic. Notice there's no E, there's no sort of bass interfering with the harmony. Then we got that, and then we got this sort of scampering strings, which is basically all the violins, the viola. Again, notice how carefully the octave doubling is. So we just have one octave between that D and that D, which is interesting. Whereas before we had two octaves between them. So it actually shifts from one octave space from two octave space to one octave space. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And notice how the cellos are divided a little bit. Digga-da-digga-da, and then somebody else takes over. Again, a Tchaikovsky technique, particularly for strings, where you sort of subdivide the line. If it went all the way through the orchestra, you might find other instruments sort of doing that with lots of divisi. Of course, divisi tends not to be used too much in a film studio setting because it will just sound a mess. So that is that. So I think that was the main point with that. And then we're on into the next sort of little bit of the puzzle. Did I go on to that? Yes. Yeah, so in bar 50, we've got this sort of block chordal melody. So here, flute 1, flute 2, flute 3, oboe 1, oboe 2, clarinet 1, 2, 3. So it's just stacked. Horns are just stacked. And then we've got this sort of interesting glock thing because, of course, they're not going to play the same note. So it's always easier to go that sort of idea, obviously with different notes. Then we got violin 1 and 2, and then viola A, viola B, in other words, the divisi viola, which is interesting. And then we've got trombone 1 on that note, trombone 2, 3, and cellos on the middle note, and then just basses on that sort of obviously though you can see how the trombone 2, 3 and the cellos reinforce that bass, as does trombone 1 as well. So lots going on in that bit. Let me just check the bar number, bar 50. So let's go into bar 50. Yep, so it's just, this is bar 49 that I'm playing. Yeah, with a little bit of that glock, which sort of gives a little bit of a tinkle again, and suspended cymbal, which makes it grow. Let's think about those notes as well. There's a lot going on. So what have I said about that? 48, 49, 50. Here we go. Rising horn planing developed. So a typical sort of wrong note bass thing. Brilliant wrong note bass passage. Divergent progression. See little people. So the bass line, which is basically just playing different notes to what's going up on there, which he does frequently. I'm ignoring the other tenor note like that. So there's a degree of separation of sound that's happening on there, but also there's a lot of blend as well. So in other words, what is playing the actual bass note? Well, we've got mostly just the bottom note of these trombones. We've then got bassoons, and then we've got the cellos and the basses. So you will hear a slightly different note here in the trombone 1 at that point. But basically, this is this. Like that. So that's our wrong note bass. Then we've got trumpets, horns 4, 5, and 6. And then we've got bass clarinets, two oboes, flute 3. Is that flute 3? Yeah. As well, all stacked. Like that. With that little rising arpeggio bit as well, which is taken over by harps at that point, with the stabs on the piano. God, it's so annoying. Just keeps changing it all the time. Just have to go all the way through just to sort of keep changing this stuff. It's just annoying. I think there is a way of doing it. I think it's just optimize selection. Let's just try that. See if it just does it all for me, kind of. Yes. So mostly stacked, basically. But interesting to see how the bass is kind of reinforced. So there is mixed at that point. There's quite a lot of sort of mixed mixed sounds rather than separation. At bar 58, unusual bend with no mix on the bottom voice. So yes, it's this sort of really weird bit. So let's have a look at bar 58. So yes. Yeah, so it's this bit in the wind which we're talking about. Yeah, notice how it just changes slightly halfway through. Yeah. So it's quite an unusual thing. So what we've got here is flute 1 and 2 on the top voice. The middle voice has the most amount of notes, which is flute 3, oboe 2 and clarinet 1. Then oboe 1 on the bottom note. So in terms of what's happening, and this is why it's probably useful to go to this bit at that point. An 0-1-3-4, so that sort of thing. So actually the principal notes are the B, C and the D, so actually the harmony note is just that. So they reinforce the harmony note, not the main notes, which I think is really interesting. And likewise in the strings, I presume it's just violin 1, violin 2, viola, or is it something else? Is there a divisi going on? I think it's a divisi going on. So interesting. So we got the violins here with the, yeah, so we got violin 1, violin 2, and then violas. So actually, as I sort of originally thought, which is interesting. So, yes, so that's effectively with a violin 2 at that point. And then we swap. So once it goes from a 3-note chord, but essentially a dyadic chord, or dyadic, very light harmony, just thirds, then we're going to flute 1 and 2, flute 3, clarinet 1, so now clarinet above oboes again, but oboe 2 and clarinet 2, and then oboe 1. So it's all sort of very muddled at that point. I think voice leading issues are away from this. And that's, so oboe 1 is playing the lead note. Okay, that I can understand. Then it just continues, and then the oboe jumps up to the middle voice once it goes from a 4-note chord or a 3-note chord with a doubled fifth to a 3-note chord with no doubling at all. So here we got root, third, fifth. So the fifth is played by flute 1 and flute 2. The third is flute 3, oboe 1 and clarinet 1. Let's just do that. And then clarinet 2 and oboe 2. At that point. So it's mixed unisons apart from the flutes just on the top. So yeah, just a kind of a little bit of detail there. Really sort of complicated because, of course, you know, it's in amongst all of this stuff. I mean, look, if you look at it, it's a bit sort of, you know, it's hugely textured at that point. So that Holst thing again going on. So let's move on. The last little bit. So we're almost through at this point. We've got some interesting little bits. Look at this technique with the bass clarinet as it sort of just jumps in to disguise the joins between bassoon 1 and 2. Isn't that clever? Love it. And you probably can't tell. A little bit, but of course it's with all the strings, so all of these units in fact will just do the whole thing. There's nothing else is playing. Yeah, so a lovely bit of scoring at that point. The just going over the join, which is really wonderful. Oboes just in unison, flutes just in unison at that point, and Yeah, all the violins and the violas in unison, they just take over here. Then they go into octaves as well, and the bass goes down and the melody goes up. So typical sort of string arrangement at that point. Then we go into this last little bit, which is wonderful. Look at that crazy alto flute, which will just simply won't be heard at all. And they've bothered to change three bars at the end just for that thing, which nobody will ever hear, which I love that sort of stuff. There it is. You know what? Weirdly, it does add a little bit of colour. Because I could hear that, because there's nothing else kind of there. We've got the B here, but amongst the G and the A, I don't think there's anything quite... Well, yeah, we got some trombones there, so it is covered at that point. But it is amazing that you can just about pick it out at that bit. Just at a slightly different texture. Yeah, so that sort of whole tone chord right at the end, which is tremendous. And all sorts of amazing things going on here. So in the reduction, I've been very, very specific. So double bass on its own, by the way. I don't think that actually has anything on the actual note. No. There's not reinforced. Ah, yes, contra bassoon. Why have I missed that? That's an aberration. I haven't put any bassoons there at all. Ah. That's very, very remiss of me. So that should be rectified immediately. So yeah, we have bassoons and bass clarinets on the cellos. Yeah. Cello one. Which is that. So yeah, a really interesting sort of array here. So double bass contra, tuba two, cello two, or the second desk of cellos, bassoons and the bass clarinet on that note, then tuba one here. So I don't think anything else plays that note. Sorry to flit around. Yeah, so I'm looking for that C sharp. I can't see it anywhere there. All I can see is just there. So that would normally be the bass trombone or a bass trombone. Yeah, nothing else playing that note at that octave. So then we've got the cellos on their own, then trombone one, or so trombone three, trombone two, trombone one. Then we've got viola doing voices five and six. We've then got voices one and three on violin one, voices two and four on violin two, a sort of typical sort of subdivision at that point. You can kind of see it on here, like that, and taking up the space there. We've got some of those notes picked out in the piano, but there's a wonderful blend to all of this, because of course with all the harmony and the bass line, okay, we went up to the trumpet sound. So that's interesting, isn't it? Because the trumpets are, or the horns rather, are playing in the, all in the area of where these are already being heard. But because they're so loud, they're ASIX, you can hear them. Brilliant sort of tremolando type effect as well. Let's just listen to that again. They really cut through those horns. Yeah, I think that was just shortened for the film, where it just all cuts off at that point. So yeah, really interesting little bits of orchestration for that. But I do quite like the alto flute. I put sort of kind of inexplicable use of the alto flute, but I can appreciate the fact that it's there, which is interesting. I suppose if you had another clarinet, you would probably have that doing that as well. So yes, interesting array of notes which emphasize this whole thing, because it's all clustered. But when you look at it in terms of what's going on, you'll see actually there's quite a lot of space in the bass at that point. Again, there's a little bit of space here, but they're not playing the very, very lowest note. They're actually emphasizing the low mids at that point. And then we've got this also in trumpets, oboe and clarinet. Look how low that third trumpet is. Which still blends with everything else rather nicely. So that's it. I think I put a chord there, E flat 9, sharp 5, sharp 11. So sharp 4, basically, sharp 5. So yeah, it's a whole tone chord. And it sounds like a sort of dominant whole tone chord, whether that's possible or not. But I think it is. So yeah, marvellous. Brilliant little piece, and that is 8M2 More Rescue, which I'm now going to resave for all my patrons and then redo all the PDFs as well. So thanks again, and I'll see you again soon. Bye for now.